This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan. I'm joined by correspondent Margaret Warner, who is off to the Koreas, just South Korea at the moment. But is this a response to the increased tensions that we've seen on the peninsula?
It is, Hari. You know, these are two countries, North and South Korea, that have remained in a state of war, technically, since the Korean War 60 years ago. And I think it's fair to say they're now closer to conflict than they have been any time in the last 60 years. And the U.S., of course, is heavily involved there. We've got 28,000 American troops. So we're going over to assess the state of the hostilities, why the hostilities, how great the risk of war is, how exposed and involved the Americans are, and then, of course, how the South Koreans feel about this. We did ask to go to the North. We did make a request, but so far it has not been responded to, so I don't think we're going there.
Just a few days ago, you had Bill Richardson on, who had just been to the North.
Yes.
What was the kind of key piece of information that he was able to share?
Well, he came back, as you know, with this ostensible offer from the North Koreans that they were ready to readmit nuclear inspectors and several other conciliatory gestures. As far as I know and as far as he knows, there's been no follow-up from the North Koreans on that. The other interesting tidbit he revealed on our program was that while he was there, some of the foreign ministry and military officials he spoke to indicated some unease with the succession plan that Kim Jong-il, the leader of North Korea, has mm-hmm. now in play to try to anoint his son as his successor. And as you know, that is one of the theories as to why they've been taking these recent provocative actions.
And what are some of the pieces that you're going to focus on in the South?
Well, in the South, first of all, as I said, we want to really look at the military state of play. And mm-hmm. everyone thinks of the DMZ as being the really contentious area. That's the land border roughly along the 38th parallel. But it's no accident that the two recent attacks by the North on the South have both occurred at sea, and there is all this disputed water between the two. And so we hope to go out with either the U.S. or South Korean military at sea and go to the island that was shelled and try to bring to our viewers the fact that there are other disputes between North and South and why that's become a particular bone of contention. Then we'll also go and talk to real South Koreans. Seoul is where most South Koreans live, is just 30 kilometers from the border, and how they feel about it and how they feel about the North and living so close to a neighbor that's really quite unpredictable with nuclear weapons, I might add.
And you've got a piece on education maybe as well?
Yes. Another aspect we would like to look at is when you look at South Korea, after the end of the Korean War, they were this completely strapped, basically agricultural half a country. And in 55 or 60 years, they've leapfrogged into a country with the 15th biggest GDP in the world. And one of the ways is educating their population. And in the recent international tests of 15-year-olds, they scored incredibly. I mean, in reading, they were number 2 in the world. The U.S. was number 17. In math, they were number 4 in the world. The U.S. was number 31. And so, you know, what is it about their education system? What they've really had to do is develop human capital because they don't really have any natural resources. The natural resources are all in the North.
All right. Margaret Warner, safe travels.
Look forward to talking to you during the trip.
All right. This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Stay with us.